Hello there, everyone. Matt here with thevirtualinstructor.com, and in this video, I'd like to share with you a little bit of instruction on combining graphite with white charcoal, which is a wonderful combination of media if you know how to combine those two types of media on toned drawing paper. And I'd also like to share with you a time lapse that's taken from a series of lessons that we just completed as part of our live lesson series over at thevirtualinstructor.com for members. Now, to access this complete lesson series, which is uncut, it's not sped up or anything, it's all recorded in real time, you do have to be a member at thevirtualinstructor.com, but our membership program starts with a free trial, so you can go in and check it out and see if it's right for you. Now, in this lesson series, we create a wonderful drawing of a rhinoceros, a very detailed and texture-oriented drawing of a rhinoceros using the combination of white charcoal and graphite on toned drawing paper. So I hope you enjoy the little bit of instruction I'm going to give you, and also the time lapse, so you can see the entire process from start to finish. Now, I want to start by talking about the materials that we're going to be using and the surface we're going to be working on here at the beginning, and then we're going to go in a little bit about combining graphite and white charcoal and some things that you need to be aware of when you're working with this combination of media. First, I am going to be working with graphite. I'm going to be using the traditional wood pencils, the ones encased in wood. Occasionally, I'll use a mechanical pencil, but for this series, we're just going to be using the wooden pencils, and you can see that I've got them sharpened to a very fine tip. And the way I get the sharp tip is just by using an X-Acto knife and basically carving the pencil down and then using a sanding pad here to rub over the surface to get a nice sharp tip. It is labor intensive to sharpen your pencils that way, but you can see it gives you this nice, really, really precise sharp tip. It's really sharper than what you can get a pencil when you use a pencil sharpener. Now, for our lighter values, we're going to be working with white charcoal, and the name of white charcoal is misleading because charcoal clearly isn't white. Charcoal is burnt organic material, and when that material is burnt, it obviously turns black. So what's the deal with white charcoal? Well, some pigments have been added to the material, and also I believe some clay constituents as well to create this material that they call white charcoal, but it's really probably not charcoal. But it does behave like charcoal. It's powdery. It behaves a lot like compressed charcoal, but of course it's white. I also have a couple of blending stumps here. We may use them, we may not. I've got them lying around. I'm not really sure if I put that on the materials list, but here they are. If you've got some within reach, you can grab them. You can also use a rolled up piece of paper. I'm not really sure we're going to use them, but blending stumps do work well with graphite and white charcoal when you're working with that combination of media. So I've got it handy. The paper we're working on here is Strathmore toned gray sketch paper. Now, a lot of people read the word sketch paper and they think, oh my gosh, it's sketch paper. This is only suitable for sketching. While you can create sketches on this type of paper, you can also create some finished professional drawings as well. You can see that this is the 400 series, which means it's their best top of the line paper. And the thing that you need to look for when you're looking for papers to work on is whether or not it's acid free. And that's really a good way to determine if a paper is worth creating a finished drawing on. And you can see here that the paper is acid free, even though some of it is recycled. You can see that it's been recycled a bit. 30% of it is recycled paper. So I'm just going to grab the HB pencil, and I want to caution you on a couple of things when working with the graphite. But first, let's talk about how you can create gradations of value with the graphite. So I'm just going to take the HB pencil and use the side of the pencil here and just create a little bit of a value scale. So you can see I'm releasing some of the pressure that I'm placing on the pencil as I work away. And I can go back and add another layer here and progressively get a little bit darker with each application. Let's go ahead and grab a little bit of a harder pencil here. We'll go ahead and grab the 4B pencil. So maybe we will use the 4B pencil tonight. And then I'm just going to release pressure here as I get close to the neutral value of the paper. So if we were creating a value scale here, we're going to go the opposite direction with the white charcoal. And obviously I'm going to put more pressure on the pencil if I want the color to be a little bit more intense or the value to the material to be a little bit more intense here. And you can see as we kind of start to overlap there, there's an interesting thing that happens. Can you see it? Might be hard to tell, but the gray in between is actually creating a different gray than the gray of the paper. That's because the white charcoal and graphite, when mixed, and white charcoal and black charcoal too, for the most part, they when they mix, they create somewhat of a cooler gray. So it's going to be slightly different gray than the gray of the paper. So we need to be aware of that. But if we want to create a nice smooth gradation between different values, we can just take the blending stump and put a little bit of pressure on it and go right over the top of this application here. And you can see what a wonderful smooth transition that makes. See that? Now it might be a little bit more obvious that the gray is a little bit different than the gray around it. It's not a huge difference, but it is a little bit different. There is an issue that arises when we're combining these two types of mediums because they are different. Graphite is not the same thing as charcoal. It's a different material, and it behaves differently on the surface. If you've ever looked at a graphite drawing, or you've ever, clearly you've looked at a graphite drawing, but if you've ever worked on a graphite drawing and maybe you started with a softer graphite pencil like a 4B and you put a lot of pressure on it and you get what's called graphite shine if you're not careful. If you apply too much of the material and it goes into the tooth of the paper, basically flattening out the tooth of the paper, what happens is the graphite reflects. Graphite is just naturally reflective. You can look at the pencil and you can see that the tip of the pencil shines. Graphite is a shiny material. Charcoal is not a shiny material. You can look at the tip and there's no shine there. And when we're combining these two mediums together, they're going to behave differently on the surface, obviously. So this is something that we need to watch out for, because if I take the HB graphite here, and I make some marks, and I decide to myself, I want to go over the top of that with some white charcoal now. Watch what happens. The white charcoal will not cover over the graphite. In fact, I'm getting quite a bit of resistance when I'm trying to go over the top of the graphite with the white charcoal. The two materials feel completely different on the surface. So what that means is we need to be very cognizant of the value that we're trying to develop in a particular area in the drawing. And it's not one of these situations where we can just put down some graphite and say, oh, I want that to be a little bit lighter in value, because you're really not going to be able to do it too well. You see that? It will go over it and it will lighten it a little bit, but it's not going to cover it up completely. So if that's the case, then we need to remove some of the graphite first with the kneaded eraser, and then we can cover it a little bit more efficiently. Essentially, we're going to be starting somewhere around in here in the value scale. And then progressively, we're going to be pushing values out in either direction. So as we develop the drawing, we'll progressively make areas darker and progressively make areas lighter. Now, for a drawing like this, I'm probably going to be working in sections like I like to work, but you don't have to take that approach. You can, of course, work on it in totality and push the values as you go through it, but I just like to have little small wins as I go through the process. So now let's start drawing this rhinoceros here.
So the first thing we need to do here is just loosely and lightly sketch out the basic shapes of the form of the rhinoceros. And you can see I've started here with just looser shapes, and then I've gone in to add the contours. Now the contours are basically the outlines. If you start with basic shapes, it makes it a whole lot easier to find accuracy with your contour line drawing. Then after we had the contours in place, we could add a few details like the eyes and the nostril, and of course the mouth. It was time to start with our graphite and white charcoal applications, and you can see here I started with a light application of the white charcoal followed by a light application of the graphite. And what we did here in this series is we added a bit of graphite and white charcoal and progressively pushed the value range outward, which of course increased the contrast and also created a full range of value. So it's always a good idea to kind of work a little bit cautiously in the beginning stages. Then you can always increase the contrast and make that value range a little bit more broad. So after we had the horn in place, we started to work our way down to the front side of the face of the rhinoceros and handle all of those wrinkles. Now, when it comes to wrinkles, a lot of people think that it's just a bunch of lines, but that's not really accurate. Wrinkles are actually small little forms. So that means based on the location of the light source, we're going to see an area of highlight. We're also going to see areas of shadow. And it's that contrast between those highlights and shadows that helps to create the illusion of wrinkles or small little recesses in the surface of the form that you're drawing here. So we started lightly, as you can tell, and then progressively we made those shadowed areas in between the wrinkles a little bit darker, and we also enhanced the highlights here with the white charcoal. Now this, of course, is a slow process. It requires quite a bit of patience, but if you're patient and you work slowly, you're sure to see some pretty successful results. Now, from the left side of the head, we progressively worked our way to the right side of the head, and during the process, we basically set up somewhat of an underpainting using a bit of graphite and the white charcoal on the surface, using the blending stump to work that into the surface, and then over the top, we applied our graphite and white charcoal applications to progressively, again, build up that range of value and, of course, increase the contrast. Now, of course, texture was incredibly important during the creation of this drawing, and texture is basically reliant on a couple of factors. The first factor, of course, is the directional strokes that you make. Of course, directional strokes can help to create the illusion of texture on the surface, but really the big way to create the illusion of texture, or the most important way to create the illusion of texture, is through your use of value. Value, of course, is the darkness or lightness of a color, and it's those value relationships that ultimately lead to the illusion of texture. So the more pronounced the contrast, the more pronounced the texture appears. So in the areas where the texture was a little bit smoother on this particular animal, there was less contrast. And in the areas where the texture was a little bit more pronounced, of course, the contrast was a little bit stronger between the dark and light values. Now, obviously, we tackled this drawing in sections, and you can see in this particular section where we created that underpainting of white charcoal and then just a bit of HB graphite over the top, and then we smoothed those applications with the blending stump before going in and developing those wrinkles. And you can see those wrinkles were first drawn by just using lines. Then once we had those lines in place, we could go in and enhance the value to create the illusion of these being small little forms rather than just lines. And that's where the texture really came to life and where the illusion was created in this particular drawing. So again, we had one last section to go here in our lesson series. And again, we started with an underpainting using that combination of white charcoal and graphite. Then over the top, we drew those lines using an HB graphite pencil before going in with a white charcoal pencil to pull out the highlights. And then going back in with a 2B and a 4B graphite pencil to make some of those shadowed areas within those wrinkles a little bit darker. Now, of course, it may seem like this process is really quick since you're watching a time lapse of this process, but it's a slow process. But if you're patient and take your time, then realistic results are definitely within your reach. And here's a look at our finished drawing.
Thanks so much for watching this video. I hope you enjoyed watching the entire process of the creation of this drawing squished down into a small time frame. Now, this complete lesson series is available to members at thevirtualinstructor.com. It consists of 9 parts. Each part is an hour long, and of course, it is uncut and it's in real time with instruction along the way. If you want to learn more about our membership program, you can. I'll leave a link in the description below. Our membership program includes weekly live lessons and, of course, our recorded live lessons. All the recorded live lessons, all the live lessons we've ever published, of course, are available to members. Our video courses on drawing and painting, which include videos and ebooks, weekly critiques as part of the Members Minute, and a year-long curriculum for visual arts teachers. Now, if you're brand new to this channel, I suggest that you subscribe. We cover a broad variety of drawing and painting mediums and subjects here on this channel. You won't be disappointed. So if you haven't subscribed yet, I encourage you to do so. If you want to check out 3 of our course videos and ebooks for free, you can do so as well. I'll leave a link in the description below this video if you want to go check that out as well. Thanks again for watching, and as always, I wish you all the very best in your artistic success.